الحمد لله رب العالمين الحمد لله الذي هدانا لهذا وما كنا لنهتدي لولا أن هدانا الله الحمد لله على نعمة الإسلام وكفى بها نعمة الحمد لله على منة الولاية وكفى بها منة وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له وأشهد أن سيدنا وعظيمنا وحبيب قلوبنا النبي المؤيد والرسول المسدد والمصطفى الأمجد والمحمود الأحمد حبيبي إله العالمين أبي القاسم محمد صلوات الله وسلامه عليه وعلى أهل بيته الطيبين الطاهرين المعصومين سفن النجاة الأعلام من ركب سفينتهم نجا ومن تخلف عنها هلك وغرق ثم أما بعد respected elders, brothers and sisters السلام عليكم جميعا ورحمة الله وبركاته Allow me, of course, first and foremost, to take this opportunity to offer my heartfelt condolences to Sahib al-Asr wa al-Zaman, Ajjalallah ta'ala, Farajahu al-Sharif, on the anniversary marking the death of none other than the second most important lady in Islam, or the third most important lady in Islam, the daughter of Amir al-Mu'mineen Ali ibn Abi Talib, none other than As-Sayyida Zaynab bint Ali, salawatullah wa salamuhu alayhim ajma'in. A similar condolences is also offered and extended to all my brothers and sisters commemorating this important event. Having said that, I would also like to take this opportunity also to thank the organizing committee and the board of directors for availing me of the opportunity to be with you during these blessed nights and important nights to basically exchange some food for thought in regard to our position in as far as our stay and residency or our living standards in this particular country and other countries around the world. Having said that, allow me also to remind all the respected audience that the lectures I will be giving starting from today are a series of 3-day lectures. So I humbly request you and ask you to attend the next 2 sessions so that there will be some sort of a follow-up as to what I'll be discussing and talking with all of your beautiful presence and attentiveness to these majalis. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala not reserve a single reward but to grant you for your patience, for your perseverance, and for all your dedication to such a great cause in reviving the teachings of Ahlul Bayt, salawatullah wa salamuhu alayhim ajma'in. One of the most often neglected perspective about Islam, when we talk about it, whether within our midst or to others, is what we call the human perspective. It is interesting to note that perhaps nothing has been as neglected as this subject, in particular also when it comes to the expedition and the revolution of our beloved and respected Imam Hussein salawatullah wa salamu alayhi. Because if one closely examines, in particular the words and the statements of Imam Hussein salawatullah wa salamu alayhi, in regard to the purpose of his revolution, or the purpose that made him come out from the safety of the city of his grandfather Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and then to venture into Mecca and ultimately arrive in the land of Karbala, you would find that throughout the course of his conversation and address to the people of his time, it was always based on that particular perspective. How to revive the human conscience, how to bring about this invigorating human conscience to take the better of the existence of the humans, whether during his time or throughout the course of the time that will follow after whatever happens as a result of his revolution, salawatullah wa salamu alayhi. One of these statements that we often hear and we often repeat so many times in our lectures and in our addresses, whether by my humble self or my colleagues, the respected alims and zakirs of this particular majalis, is the khutbah or the speech that he gave, salawatullah wa salamu alayh, marking the beginning of his expedition when he said, ma kharashtu ashiran wala batara wala mufsidan wala zalima wa innama kharashtu li talab al islah fi ummati jaddi rasulullah amuru bil ma'ruf wa anha anil munkar wa asiru bi sirati jaddi rasulullah wa abi ali ibn abi talib salawatullah wa salamuhu alayh. Basically what the imam says, I have not come out of for the purpose of fame, for the purpose of mischief, for the purpose of creating oppression on earth. Rather, I came out for the purpose of reform. That's the point I want to go into. The purpose of reform. Reform from what? Reform from derailing from the pure teachings of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Whereby, in order to bring that reform, my duty is to do two things. Enjoy what is right and stop what is evil. This is the whole paradigm of reform, is to enjoy what is right and to stop what is evil. But in the course of enjoying what is right and forbidding what is evil, there are certain protocols and etiquettes to execute amr bil ma'ruf and nahi anil munkar. Not everyone has the ability to articulate amr bil ma'ruf and nahi anil munkar. Right? Sometimes in the course of executing Amr bil Ma'ruf and Nahi an al-Munkar, we actually make people stay away from our faith, whether within our internal setups or outside our own setups. The methodology of enforcing or executing Amr bil Ma'ruf and Nahi an al-Munkar has to be in conformity with two things. Number one, it has to be in conformity with the standards and the spirit of the Quran, and it has to conform also with the standard and the spirit of the teachings of Rasulullah and Ahlul Bayt. And this is what we derive from the statement of Imam Hussein himself. He says, Amur bil ma'ruf wa anha anil munkar. I enjoy what is right and forbid what is evil. Based on what? Based on the teachings of my grandfather Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam and the methodology of my father Ali ibn Abi Talib salawatullah wa salamuhu alayhi. Therefore, allow me, after this brief introduction, to say from the outset that Islam, by definition, is a word that means peace, but not verbally. It means peace by virtue of practice. Therefore, if I believe in a system to perpetrate peace, I myself then have to believe in that system as an encompassment and an embodiment of that peace. Otherwise, if I don't feel that peace within me, that contentment within me, that what is within Allah's hands is more worthy than what is in my hand, I cannot perpetrate that system. Look at Zaynab, salawatullah wa salamuhu alayha. She says, when she was being ridiculed, of course, these holy personalities, no one can ridicule them. But Ubaidullah ibn Ziyad in Kufa was trying to ridicule Sayyida Zainab, salawatullah wa salam alayhi, when he attributed the killing of Imam Hussein to Allah. He said, how did you see what Allah has done to your brother? Look at the fallacy. How did you see? كيف رأيت صنع الله بأخيك؟ هو مو صنع الله. It is not what Allah desired. It is not Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that wanted Imam Hussein to be killed and martyred and slaughtered in that fashion. Rasul Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave you a paradigm. When you move away from the paradigm and you decide to go against the paradigm and you act in a manner against that paradigm, then you are responsible, not Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So to say or to attribute the killing of Imam Hussein to Allah is a fallacy. But look at the response. And that is the beauty of Amr bil Ma'ruf and Nahi an al-Munkar, is that when we learn the etiquette of these holy personalities, salawatullah wa salamu alayhi, what did she say? Was she angered? Of course she was angered. But did she display her anger in front of Ubaydullah ibn Ziyad in that particular moment where the situation was extremely tense? The feelings were on hype. Because you know what happened to Ahlul Bayt? Their tents were looted, their tents were burnt, they were taken as prisoners of war, they were chained, they were dragged on the plains of Karbala, they were not allowed to be treated with dignity, and then to be presented in the courtyard of a tyrant, the caliber of Ubaydullah ibn Ziyad. So she says what? She gave the most graceful, the most amazing, the most lofty of all the loftiness of statement that a person can ever give. She said, "Ma ra'aytu illa jamila." Allahu Akbar. I have not seen except beauty. That's peace. That's contentment. That's rida bi qada Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That's absolute surrender to what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants us to accept when we are being challenged on the basis of our faith, on the basis of our belief system, and not to reciprocate anger, not to reciprocate hate, not to reciprocate mistreatment with all these similar, you know, treatments, but rather to reciprocate any of ill treatments with sublimity and an address of loftiness. And that's what we can learn from these great personalities such as Sayyida Zainab salawatullah wa salamuhu alayha. So by definition, Islam is a word of peace, or a word that means peace, but not just on the verbal aspect, but also in the practical sense as well. In fact, it goes beyond that. It goes to illustrate that the word Islam or Muslim is synonym with the word human. Yani if I ask someone, what does it mean to be a Muslim? Immediately, without hesitation, the answer should be a synonym to Muslim is human. Because in your humanity, which is actually a soul that has a personality, it is not a personality that has a soul. There's a huge difference. If we look at ourselves, brothers and sisters, as a soul that has a personality, not a personality that has a soul, then your worth is much more to yourself before it is to Allah in how you would operate under a paradigm of soul as opposed of operating under the paradigm of a personality. Right? Because your soul is your existence. You are a human being by virtue of your soul. And if you examine your soul that has been created by Allah is that of purity. It is the personality that emblemishes it and not vice versa. And that's why the focus should be on the soul as opposed to the personality. Because once we focus on the soul, the personality remains in check. Right? The personality of a human being remains in check throughout the course of our existence. Sometimes, then what comes to mind in order to understand the refining or the refinement or the refined personality of certain individuals that we live next to them, it can then easily be understood why people are able to maintain a personality that is pure throughout the course of their life. To such an extent that you don't see them going outside the scope of what their soul dictates. Why? Because they see their existence from the perspective of their soul, not from the perspective of their personality. And this is something that can be measured. You know, this is something that can be measured. It is not something that is hypothetical. If you base your life on the existence of your soul, it can be measured. Just like you can measure faith. You know, you can measure faith in the words of Imam. For example, Imam Ja'far al-Sadiq, salawatullah wa salamu alayhi. Imam Ja'far al-Sadiq, salawatullah wa salamu alayhi, when he was asked in regard to the question of one's faith, how can a person determine if he is someone that exercises in practical living standards, a faithful personality. You know, because you need to have some sort of introspectiveness within yourself. It is not good enough to be satisfied, brothers and sisters, on the basis that I'm doing well. You know why? Because we are all like the moon. We all have our dark sides, right? But no one knows that dark side except yourself. That's when it becomes a requirement to look at that dark side and say, look, I have to begin the process of self-refinement, right? I have to start the exercise or the idea of self-refinement. And before I go to the hadith of Imam Ja'far al-Sadiq, in passing, let me also mention the hadith of Imam al-Kadhim, salawatullahi wa salamu alayhi, in which he says, in regard to this issue of self-refinement, he says, "Laysa minna ahlal bayt." He is not among us, the followers of Ahlul Bayt. Yani the Imam is attributing us, brothers and sisters, to them. That if we want to call ourselves the followers of Ahlul Bayt, the word Shia, brothers and sisters, is not a cheap term. Wallahi al-Azim, it is not a cheap term. It's a term that comes with a duty and a responsibility. Why? Because it represents the purity of the teachings of Rasulullah. Salawatullahi wa salam alayhi. And this is indicated in the hadith of Imam al-Kadhim. Laysa minna ahlal bayt. He is not counted among us, the family of the Prophet, those who do not bring themselves to account on a daily basis. Laysa minna ahlal bayt man lam yuhasib nafsahu fi kulli layla. Every night we must come to self-examination. Spare 5 minutes of your time? What is 5 minutes of our time? 5 minutes investing 5 minutes of our time on ourselves can have unmeasurable results and outcomes. On the basis of listing a journal or keeping a spiritual journal by virtue of which we list the positive and the negative of our own personality. And once we recognize our positiveness as opposed to our negativeness, then we can proceed forward by encouraging and elevating our positiveness and by discouraging and working on our negativeness. Now that soul, if it works from that paradigm, how then that soul could ever go astray or go outside the parameters of what is required from it? Imam Ali, Imam Ja'far al-Sadiq says, in order to know our faith and how it is measurable, look what he says. And that is the beauty of looking introspectively. Don't worry about people. You know, there comes a time where when we engage in self-reform, because we are the constituents of the community we live in. If we work on ourselves, the community will change and ultimately the society will change. Because communities and societies are made of what? Individuals, right? It is that individual that needs to be reformed. Nothing else. It is not going to come from above. The reform of society is not something that comes from, we will wait for the Imam to rise. If that is our anticipation of the rise or the ghaiba, in fact, or the occultation of the Imam, is that he's going to come and fix our problems for us, then we have really misunderstood the whole concept behind the ghaiba of the Imam, salawatullahi wa salamu alayhi. The whole idea behind the ghaiba of the Imam, salawatullahi wa salamu alayhi, is to reach a level of human perfection by virtue of exercising our intelligence for reform until a time where it comes that we've reached our maximum potentials and we cannot proceed further, then the Imam rises to take us to a level higher than our own negligence and shortcomings. That's what we should execute in our, you know, level of practice in this. Imam Ja'far al-Sadiq says, to be able to measure your faith, you need to adopt the following methodology. To behave in such a manner that when you are in private, you are the same as you are in public. Huh? That is the issue. How to measure yourself that you are someone that is actually following the teachings of Ahlul Bayt and Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam is to be someone that behaves in private in the same manner he behaves in public. That is a very important statement. It's a very profound statement. And you know, Ahlul Bayt, they don't just speak for the sake of speaking, right? They speak for the sake of changing, for the sake of bringing within our existence and within our setups the ability to reform ourselves. Because if you sit with yourself, now there is no Raqib, no Atid, as in other people. There is Raqib and Atid. These two never go on holidays, by the way. Well, Christmas Eve, Christmas Day, Koshali, no, they're always working, right? There are 24/7 non-stop writing, whatever we are. But I'm saying there is no Raqib from people, from your counterparts. So that is the time when we are at our best in what? In self-criticism. Because there is no one to know what you are criticizing yourself with, right? There's a sense of what we call in the English world transparency. You become transparent with yourself. In our colloquial language, we say, stop kidding yourself. There's no need. Now you're alone. Be at least transparent with your own setup. Because that's how change is created. And look at Imam Ali salawatullahi wasalam. Imam Ali is a ma'soom imam. You think that ma'soom imam did not bring himself to account? He did bring himself to account. When his companion by the name of, Zurara, goes to Sham on a visit after the martyrdom of Imam Ali salawatullahi wasalam alayhi, and Muawiyah, he is about his coming. And he knows that this person was one of the closest confidant to Imam Ali salawatullahi wasalam alayhi. So he invites him to his palace, to his courtyard. He comes because he knows he's a tyrant, you know. So he says, I compel you to describe Ali for me. He says, in your presence, it's impossible. I can't describe Ali in front of you. Because there is no safety or immunity for my life. Right? Muawiyah says, I'll guarantee your safety. Speak about Ali ibn Abi Talib. And speak at liberty. So the man says, I speak according to what I know. You don't interrupt. Okay? Whatever I say, I don't want interrupt. He says, you have been given the aman, they call it. Okay, so he starts. He says, we used to be in his company. He was like one of us, though we would not speak before him out of awe and respect to his grandeur. Yet he was one among us. He would come, sit with us, talk to us, but we would never precede him with talking unless he begins first, out of respect. Then he says, I witnessed him in one of the nights of cold weather, sitting in his niche, crying like a mother who had lost a loved one. All right? In his niche, crying like someone who had lost a loved one, speaking to the world, saying to it, are you trying to lure me? This is self-account. This is self-introspective. What refinement, although he is refined, right? But the Imam wants to constantly remind us of our neglectful self, that this is how you should act when you are alone. قَابِضٌ عَلَىٰ لِحْيَتِهِ يَتَمَلْمَلُ تَمَلْمُلَ الْمَلِيمِ. He is holding his beard, swaying from one side to another, like someone who had lost or bereaved by the loss of a very dear one, saying to the world, to me have you been trying to lure me? I have divorced you irrevocably. Ajib. Don't come to Ali ibn Abi Talib. Imam Zain al-Abidin, salawatullahi wa salam alayhi, in the question of self-reform, says what? In dua makarim al-akhlaq. Please, brothers, read these du'as. Read them with, you know, with reflection, with absolute encompassment of the meaning of what is in those words of our Imam, Imam Zainul Abidin, again a ma'soom Imam. He speaks to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He says, oh Allah, every time you elevate me on the words and perception of people, right? People come and they elevate me, right? They say, oh mashallah, you are so and so. Huh? The Dr. Mustafa was saying all this introduction. Who am I? A humble servant, insignificant creation of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We are nothing before Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Wallah, we are nothing. And it is Allah's favor on us that people recognize us. Otherwise, what do we count in this world? Nothing. Your virtue and your importance in this world is not on the basis of your financial worth. It is on the basis of your moral worth. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says that. He says, innakum lan tasa'u an-nasa bi amwalikum fasa'awhum bi akhlaqikum. Ajib. Rasulullah says, surely you will not be able to satisfy people on account of your wealth. How much can you give around? This is not enough, right? I don't have enough even if I was a billionaire to give around or to give to people. Rasulullah recognized that fact. He said, you will never be able to satisfy people on the basis of your wealth, but surely and without a doubt, you have the ability to satisfy people on account of your akhlaq. Right? How is it? Is it not possible to satisfy a room full of people on the basis of my akhlaq? What does it take? Does it take much to smile in the face of your brother? Does it take much to initiate peace on your brother, whether he is a brother in Islam or a brother in humanity? Let us not be absent-minded. Wallah, brothers and sisters, take it from me as your humble servant who is insignificant in the eyes of Allah. I'm not saying that to bash anyone. Verbally, of course, not physically. I don't have the body. But even verbally, it is not my style. Right? To abuse or to say something out of place. But is it not possible, brothers and sisters? Or is it not a crime? And I begin with myself. Is it not a crime to confine Imam Hussein to our mosque and Imam Bargas? Is it not a crime that Imam Hussein is only recognized by his followers? Or very specific followers too. Not the majority of the Muslim Ummah, unfortunately. Now, why should we deny Hussein from the Christians? Why should we deny Hussein from the Jews? Why should we deny Hussein from your average Fedinkum American who lives next door to you? Right? We have a writer by the name of Antoine Barra. Go and read about him. He's a Syrian Christian writer, philosopher. He writes in one of his books, one of his writings, he said, by Allah, if we had Hussein, he's saying this, by Allah, if we had Hussein, we would have created a banner, alam, you know? He said, we would have established alam. We would have joined Hussein with Jesus. Huh? Hussein with Jesus. And I guarantee you, we will rule over the world. Why? Because of the principles of Hussein, salawatullah wa salam. Because of the human perspective of Hussein ibn Ali, salawatullah wa salamuhu alayh, when he stands outside the court in his second farewell to his family members and he begins to cry, salawatullah wa salamu alayh. Sayyidah Zainab comes out and says, why are you crying? Have you remembered your colleagues, your friends? He said, no. He said, is it bereaving you that you lost all your children? He says, no, that's not the reason. Is it because you're alone? He says, no, that's not the issue. She says, then what is the issue? He said, the issue is I hate for these people to enter hellfire on account of my death. That's humanity at its best, right? If that is not humanity, then what is humanity? You tell me, right? When you care for your enemy, that they should go somewhere that you don't like for yourself, that is the epitome and the summit of human existence. And that was displayed by Imam Hussein, salawatullah wa salamuhu alayhi, in that regard. Then the hadith continues about Imam Ali, so that I finish the hadith. Then Muawiyah says to that person. He says, would you rather see yourself hurt in place of Ali ibn Abi Talib? He says, let's hypothetically say that you were in a position where you can replace yourself with Ali ibn Abi Talib. Yani, let Ali ibn Abi Talib take yourself in sacrifice of yourself. He says, by Allah, I would not rather see Ali hurt by a prickle. Not that he takes my place. Not with a thorn. Right? Because what we saw through Ali ibn Abi Talib, the like of you and others could never understand. Could never understand. Because Ali ibn Abi Talib did not live for himself. And that's what we need to incorporate in our systems. That when we look at the life of our imams, we should understand that their existence was not for the virtue of their self-excellence, but rather to see their excellence reflected in the humans that he lived amongst. Salawatullah salam alayhim ajma'in. You know? Let there be no confusion then, or doubt therefore, that anything other than the above description that I gave about Islam is not Islam, nor is it associated with it in form or actually in context. In order to achieve this, all of what we've spoken about so far, we must realize that if the person we disagree with in opinion, and this is the style of Ahlul Bayt, by the way, if the person that we disagree with in opinion knew that our hearts thrusts with love towards him or her, he will definitely be drawn towards us. Right? If your so-called or perceived enemy, and we make our enemies, by the way. We perceive our own enemies. We create a facade and a fantasy of enemies within our own system and paradigm. Because we look at others through our own shortcomings. That's the problem. But if we are able to look at others by actually overlooking their shortcomings, then we will find it in ourselves to accommodate them and to accept them. So here, Islam requires us, in order to embrace the other, we must let go of our own prejudice. Right? Of our own prejudice. How often a time, Sallu ala Muhammad wa alim. We often, ya Allah, sorry, Sallu ala Muhammad wa alim Muhammad. How often we see ourselves, for example, among our own communities or our own friends and circles of friends, and then we come across a particular scene. Group of non-Muslims, for example, a group of non-believers, so to speak. And a thought comes to our mind that these people are, and we say it in the most, you know, discriminatory way, they're kafirs. Many times. let's not kid ourselves. This thought process comes to us. Now, they're kafirs. They are the woods for Jahannam, right? Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, when he used to look at his enemy, his paradigm of thinking was 180 degrees, different to us. He used to look at them and he used to say the following phrase, oh Allah, forgive my people, not my enemies. Not once he said enemies. Salawatullahi salam. The famous story, you know it, of At-Ta'if, where Rasulullah went At-Ta'if. There was no Abu Jahl, no Abu Lahab, no Utbah, no Walid, no none of this, no As ibn Wa'il, none of these, you know, top-notch Quraysh, you know, leaders of idol worshippers as they used to believe in. He went for what? He said, if the Meccans don't want to listen to me, maybe at Ta'if people will listen to me. So let me go and see these people. Maybe Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will guide their hearts. Cut the story short. He goes, preaches to them. The moment he goes in, the agents of the Meccans have already preceded Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam to inform the people of Taif that this Muhammad, Allahumma salli ala Muhammad wa ali Muhammad, is coming and heading forward. He wants to use his spell and sorcery on you. Don't believe in him. You know what is so crazy sometimes? So crazy is sometimes you don't want to be a believer. Ya akhi, don't go and tell someone else don't be a believer, right? And you don't want to believe. Leave others alone, you know? Let people fetch for themselves. Let people decide for themselves. You're a culprit. You don't want to be in that family of believers. Let people decide, you know? But today there is a system in this world we are living in is what? A systematic system towards what? Towards vacating faith from the life of people. To such an extent, that atheism has become fashionable. It's a fashion statement. If someone goes, you know, the literate circles or the academic circle, people pride themselves on saying that I'm an atheist. It's a fashion statement, you know. It is disgraceful, therefore, to say I'm a believer in today's world. Right? This is the paradox of time that we are living in. But hope should not be, you know, abandoned in order to reform these people. I'll tell you why. Because of the story that I'm about to conclude with the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So he says to them, believe. Instead of replying logically, they throw stones at him. To such an extent that the riwayat says that his blood that came out of his forehead mixed with the sand that he was walking upon. Salawatullahi salama. And Rasulullah made his famous statement, "Ma udhiya nabiyyun kama udhiyat." No prophet has suffered the way I had suffered because of us. He didn't suffer for himself. Rasulullah knew where he was going. He suffered for us. That's his statement. So he gets beaten, he gets sworn at, humiliated, persecuted, he goes away. And then he sits under a palm tree and he begins to communicate. Look how the beauty of a mu'min. Where does he go when he's being hurt? He does not retaliate. He goes in a retreat with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Because Allah knows what is happening. Jibreel comes to Ibrahim when he was about to be thrown from the catapult into the fire. He says, do you have any haja, mas'ala? He says, no, ilmuhu bihali yughnini an su'ali. Ya Allah. He says, his knowledge of my situation is suffice for me not to ask him for what is happening to me. He knows what is happening to me. He decided that I, you know, be in the catapult for the purpose of preaching and propagating his religion. Because, you know, propagation of faith comes with a responsibility, comes with duty, comes with protocols, comes with perseverance. Imam Ali, salawatullahi wa salamu alayhi, the Imam of his time, salawatullahi wa salamu alayhi, he endured so much suffering like his cousin Rasulullah, sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi wa sallam, until his last moment, and on the strike night of his own death, salawatullahi wa salamu alayhi, they present his killer to him. He says, loosen his chains. This is the killer of Ali ibn Abi Talib. What heart did Ali ibn Abi Talib have towards his own enemies? Salawatullah. Why? Because the purpose is higher than the self. In the mindset of Ali ibn Abi Talib, the purpose is what? What is the agenda of Ali ibn Abi Talib? Islam. The agenda of Ali ibn Abi Talib to refine the human existence. The agenda of Ali ibn Abi Talib is to make a proper human being out of you. It is not whether he, in the process of executing his justice, he wins or loses. As long as truth prevails, right? When you set out yourself in this world, brothers and sisters, the question is not about win or loss. The question is, in the process of the execution of what I'm doing, will truth prevail? Even if it was or it meant a personal loss to my existence, if it is, then let it be, because eventually the truth will prevail. And that's what counts, not my insignificant existence on this earth, right? And these are the teachings of Ali ibn Abi Talib. Salawatullah wa salamuhu alayhim ajma'in. Sallu ala Muhammad wa ali Muhammad. Takes a retreat, communicates with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and look what he says. إِذَا إِن لَمْ يَكُن بِكَ غَضَبٌ عَلَيْهِ فَلَا أُبَالِي. He says to Allah, if you are not displeased with what I'm doing, despite all that is happening to me, then I worry not. يعني تركت الخلق طرا فيه وأيتمت العيال لكي أراك والله لو قطعوني في حبك إربا ما مال الفؤاد إلى سواك. Imam Hussein on the plains of Karbala, he communicates with Allah. He says, I have abandoned the whole world out of love to be in your presence. By Allah, I make you witness. If I was to be cut into pieces, my heart will never sway away from your presence. Huh? Look at that refined belief system of the Imam salawatullahi alayhi wa sallam. Let them cut me to pieces. Who cares? As long as you are satisfied. Huh? Imam Hussein throws the blood of Ali ibn al-Asghar salamullah alayh towards heaven in order to what? Have you ever asked yourself this question? Why did Imam Hussein throw the blood of Ali ibn al-Asghar towards heaven? You know, because the riwayah says, had it, according to Imam al-Baqir, had a drop come down to earth, Allah would have shaken the entire existence under the feet of those enemy lines. Even then, Imam Hussein was concerned about them. So he threw it towards heaven. So, Ya Allah, you accept. Don't bring it down, because I'm still hoping that these people will repent. Ajib. Ajib, these imams. Wallah al-Azim. I have never seen. You know, when people say, why do you love them? Give us another alternative. We will follow them. Give us such refined people. Ya ammi atuna mathal. Give us a role model. Give us a paradigm other than these refined human beings. And we'll see whether we'll follow them or not. But do you find someone the caliber of Ahlul Bayt salamullah? It's not a matter of prejudice. It's a matter of logical inference that these people did not live for themselves. They lived for the world. Surely they deserve to be role models and followed. Simple. It doesn't take a genius to come to that particular conclusion. إن لم يكن بك غضب علي فلا أبالي. Right? If you are not dissatisfied with my services, you're happy, then I'm content. Imam Hussein, after he throws the blood, look what he says. He doesn't say enough. He says, أرضيت. Are you satisfied? You, Allah, not me. Now, you know, we pray two rak'at namaz. Oh, wow. I've done it, man. What are you talking about? For two rak'at namaz, you know, you want to show off with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. It's, you know, they say a story, ma'alish, yani, I know it's majlis aza, but to bring some light into this majlis, a man went to heaven after they could not find one single deed for him, except one. Allah wanted him to go to heaven. It's a joke, of course, don't take it literally, and then say, Sheikh said this, so this is a fatwa. It's not a fatwa, right? So the man goes, Allah says, find something for him. They find one good deed. But when was this good deed actually executed? He was drunk. Coming out of a pub, he saw a poor person. He gave him a dollar. Allah says, it's okay. I'll consider it a good deed. Enter paradise. So this man, Allah, he's boasting. He thinks he's, you know, the shabih of Imam Ali somehow. You know, that now he's in Jannah. So he goes to the Malaika. You know, I used to hear in dunya, these zakirs, they tell us there is, you know, rivers of wine. Where are they? He says, go to the corner, you'll find them. So he goes. After a while, now he's sober, this guy. He says, you know, we also heard our maulans. You see, they're women. Their beauty is so mesmerizing. If one of them looks on the earth, it will make people hang in awe. One of the angels came to him and said, come here. It was a dollar that you gave. You want the whole Jannah in half an hour? It was a dollar that you gave, for God's sake. هو دولار. دولار تشتري الجنة بها كلها. It was dollar, for God's sake. And that's how sometimes we think ourselves, that we have done such little insignificant work. And now we are, you know, doing favors on Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That, Ya Allah, we've done this. Ya Allah, we've done that. Especially when we are put to a trial or a test. And you know, Imam Ali, salawatullahi wasalamu alayhi, in regard to trials and tests, you know what he says? He says, trials and tests for zalimeen is adab. For the oppressors is a form of what? Of a form of, not punishment, it's a form of discipline. And for the mu'mineen, it's a form of elevation. Allahu Akbar. And sometimes a mu'min does not do enough. Allah gives him a challenge in his life. He perseveres, he remains patient. Allah on the day of judgment says, this is your position, but on the basis of your perseverance and patience, your position is now here. Elevation, elevation, you know? So when a challenge comes, welcome it. Don't push it away from you because it's for our own elevation and for our own benefits. It's not against us. Right? So here comes the question of Imam Hussein salawatullah wa salamu alayh, when he says what? When he says the following. He says, Aradit, are you satisfied? Now Imam Hussein knows the satisfaction of Allah comes in what? In wholesomeness, not in parts. Okay? Not in parts. Companions are gone? Good. Family members are gone? Good. Right? Children are gone, good. Women are taken as prisoners of war, good. But there is one person still alive, Hussein ibn Ali, salawatullahi wasalamu alayhi. He needs to be sacrificed as well. So he follows his statement by a more profound statement. He says, Aradit, are you satisfied? Then take until you are satisfied. So it means if your satisfaction that I should also go, take me. Take, yeah, why? Because there is no concept in the mind of Imam Hussein that we give Allah what is left. We give Allah what is best. We give Allah what is best, not what is left. When we give Allah what is left, then our setup in terms of synchronization with the existence of Allah and what Allah expects from us is lacking, right? And that covers all aspects of our existence, brothers and sisters. All aspects. Whether it is social, whether it is moral, whether it is financial. That is something no one likes to talk about. You know, the financial, the pocket. Because when it comes to the pocket, we all have Parkinson's disease. And we start shaking. You know. Our hands doesn't want to leave. You know, it's a challenge. Wallah, it's a challenge. No one can deny the fact that giving for the sake of Allah is a challenge, right? But our imams displayed the most honorable way of giving. They gave of their time, they gave of their life, they gave of their akhlaq, they gave of their existence, they gave of their wealth. Salawatullah wa salamu alayhi. Imam Hassan, they say in Arabic, they say this, I don't know how to put it in English. He says that he traded his wealth 2.5 times with Allah. What does that mean? Yani he gave all of his wealth to Allah the first time. Then he gave all of his wealth the second time. Then on the third time, he gave half of it. So someone, why 2.5 times? Is it 2.5 times? Is because the imam, when he gives, he has to give more than anyone else. So twice he traded his wealth with Allah. Why? Because he's confident is what is in Allah's hand is more secure than what is in his hand. Right? So if I give it, Allah will always give it back. So why the half time? For those who can't afford it. Subhanallah. So in Islam, everyone is covered. Everyone is covered. You have a little, give it. Allah will replace it. If you can't give it, give half of it. If you can't give half of it, give a portion of it. Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, protect yourself from entry into hellfire. Even by virtue of giving half a date. Half a date. Not a date. Half a date. One of the people who are in existence, you know, some companions, you know, people who were poor at the time of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. He said, Ya Rasulullah, what happens if someone does not even own half a date? Is that possible? No one has half a date at his house? Yes, some people don't. Half a date in their house. Look what Rasulullah he says, then your worth is nothing? You don't have half a date? No. Look at the eloquence of Rasulullah. He said, then satisfy Allah with a sip of water. Give someone a sip of water, ya akhi, as a form of charity. Who cannot afford a sip of water? Right? Who cannot afford a sip of water? This is the paradigm that Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam exhibits before us. How am I going with time? Another half an hour? No, inshallah, I will cut it short because we have plenty of time over the next 2 nights. Hostility, therefore, brothers and sisters, does not make a person closer to the other, since hostility, without a doubt, creates a barrier between us and others. We must therefore learn how to embrace, encompass, and accept others, and how to love and not hate. How to love and not hate. Because on account of love, people are drawn to you. People are attracted to you. It bereaves me, brothers and sisters, that when I attended once an interfaith program, this is something we are lacking on, brothers and sisters. I was speaking to one of the brothers. I said, we cannot afford to forfeit our friendship with the family of the believers, regardless where they come from, whether they are Christians, Jews, whatever field of belief system they belong to. But they believe in the existence of God. We cannot afford to lose their friendship, because of the fact that there is a rival system that wants to take God completely out of the equation. And he kicks in the hadith of Imam Ali, salawatullahi salamu alayhi, when he said to Malik al-Ashtar, people are of two kinds, either your brothers in faith or your equal in humanity. What a statement. You know, people don't know this. Wallah al-Azim, I said once this statement through a sister of ours. There is a sister that works with us on Islamic activities in Perth, Western Australia. I said, pass this remark to the Buddhist. She had a meeting with the Buddhist. She had a meeting with the representative of the Dalai Lama. You know, his number one representative came to Australia. So she had a meeting with him to discuss interfaith programs. She told him, one of our sages, Yani Ali ibn Abi Talib, salawatullahi wasalamu alayhi, said that people are of two kinds. Either your brothers in faith, yani Muslims, right? Or they are your equal in humanity. You know what his reply was? How could you keep such treasures away from mankind? He said, why? I've never heard a statement as profound as this statement. And it's coming from a Muslim? Who is an ordinary Muslim? He's Ali ibn Abi Talib, salawat wa salamu alayhi. Not your average human being. Right? When he says it, he means it. It's not just for the sake of rubbing shoulders with others, you know? No, Ali ibn Abi Talib does not rub shoulders with others, brothers and sisters. He's the one who said, I shall never foster compromise on the basis of weakening my faith. So he does not rub shoulders. When it comes to a belief system, Ali ibn Abi Talib does not rub shoulders. But does Ali ibn Abi Talib believe that people are of two kind, either your brothers in faith or your equal in humanity, regardless of where they come from? Yes. Ali ibn Abi Talib does believe that any human being out there is what? Is actually worthy of my love and respect. Because that's my duty. Since I believe that I have a mission. And that mission that I believe in is actually a mission for the refinement of one and all, not for the refinement of our own community. No, we should go beyond the refinement of our community. Our world as Muslims, brothers and sisters, should not be restricted to our own setups. Our world should be the entire universe that we live in. Not only this world, not this piece of land that we live in. We should include each and everyone in our love. But the problem is, we can't even get ourselves to love our own brothers. You know, when we are doing Salatul Eid sometimes, we're praying in Salatul Eid, right? Allahumma, اللهم أهل الكبرياء والعظمة وأهل الجود والجبروت وأهل عفو والرحمة وأهل التقوى أسألك بحق هذا اليوم الذي جعلته للمسلمين عيدا ولمحمد صلى الله عليه ذخرا وشرفا وكرامة ومزيد أن تصلي على محمد وأن تدخلنا في كل خير أدخلت فيه محمد وأن تخرجني من كل سوء أخرجت منه تدخلني في كل خير وتخرجني من كل سوء. To make me enter in every good that you have given to Muhammad wa al Muhammad, and to take me away from every mischief or evil you have taken or kept away from Muhammad wa al Muhammad. But you know, when we are praying, what we are doing? Allah, just here, not here, just here. You know, when you want to enter me, just here. But how about this poor person, Muslim, standing? No, I hate him. Just here. Ajeeb. La ilaha illallah. You think Allah is going to respond then to your dua? If this is the mindset that we have, just because I have a contentious issue with someone before, whatever the issue may be, right? Get it in yourself to look beyond his shortcomings in order to embrace him, in order to make him realize that your love is so profound that you are willing to overcome his shortcomings. Willing to overcome his shortcomings. Of course, within our limited capacity as humans, right? We have our own limited capacity. Sallu ala Muhammad wa ali Muhammad. So what do we learn from our beloved Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi wa sallam in his quest and affection that he never held grudges and his words were never harsh or condescending towards others? When he in fact would hear the insults and accusation, and he would face this by saying, after he was communicating with Allah following his return from At-Ta'if, and when the angel came to ask him, do you want any help in terms of eliminating these people from the face of this earth for the hurt they caused you? Rasulullah turns to another prayer. He says, oh God, forgive my people because they do not know. Do not torment them, oh God. Give them so that what? Give them an opportunity. Perhaps in this night they will be guided to thy love and acceptance. Look at this, Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. If anyone has the right, you know, to respond to the hurt he has sustained, it would be Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, right? Yet when he comes back victorious into Mecca, one of the companions is carrying, you know, it's a practice, you carry alam. He enters Mecca, he starts to recite something like a prose or poetry. He says, al-yawm yawmul malhama, al-yawm tuhtakul huruma. If, you know what that means? Our Arab counterparts, they know. This is a bad statement. This guy is calling out as they enter Mecca, today is a day of war. Today, the dignity of Meccans will be taken away. Ya Allah, Rasulullah says, this is not what we came for. This is not the mission. This is not the purpose. So he goes and he says to Imam Ali, go, replace the words. With what, ya Rasulullah? Say, O Ali, al-yawm yawmul marhama, al-yawm tuhmal hurama. Allahu Akbar. Today is a day of mercy. Today we guarantee the dignity of the Meccans. Ajeeb. Look at the 180 degree. Imagine if this is the Islam we project to people. In our quest to propagate, because you know, when we propagate our faith, we don't propagate on the purpose of wanting people to revert. That's the least of my concern. My concern is I am actually promoting a mission by virtue of which, if you don't want to join me, at least don't hinder the activities of my mission. Right? Let others benefit from the fruits of this particular propagation work so that people can, with their own intelligence, decide for themselves whether this is a system that they want to adopt and accept and follow or not. Don't be someone that blocks that. And the beauty of Islamic legislation, brothers and sisters, goes towards that very much in the spirit of the implementation of propagation work. Look at the shares or the dividends of zakat. Dividends of zakat. Remember this very carefully in your minds, brothers and sisters, because it's time we think outside the box, not inside the box. What is thinking outside the box? The dividends of zakat comes in 8 portions. To the orphan, to the wayfarer, to the miskeen, to the amilin alayha, yani the one that work to collect it, they get a share as wages because they have to go and collect it. So they are given a share. And here comes the bombshell. وَالْمُؤَلَّفَةُ قُلُوبُهُمْ. The ones that you need to win their hearts over. Yani non-Muslims. Non-Muslim. You pay zakat to non-Muslim to win their, yani to what? To create what we call in our modern standard a buffer zone. You know the buffer zone? The those who don't want to join the faith, But by the same token, they don't want to act against the faith. Right? So you pay to a journalist, for example, you put an article or a column in New York Times, say something positive about Islam, here's $500,000. You can, according to the legislation of zakah. You know what fascinates me when I read the history of zakat distribution at the time of the Prophet, and then when I think about it carefully, it really, really syncs so well with the overwhelming spirit and objective of the mission of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. You know who Rasulullah paid that share of zakat to? Abu Sufyan. He paid it to Abu Sufyan. You know why? Because Rasulullah is telling Abu Sufyan, listen, you have a big mouth. I don't have time for you. Okay? I need to continue my message. And I need to continue the message as smoothly as possible. Right? So take that share, at least, ya akhi, عيفna, مثل ما يقولون بالعرب, عوفna, مثل ما يقولون our brothers, the Iraqis, they said, leave us alone. Huh? Just leave us alone. Just keep your harm away from us. Ajib. This is thinking outside the box. You know why? Because the legislator is Allah, not a human being. The legislator, Allah, understands the mindset of humans. He knows how they function and how they think. And in order to go beyond that, then we need to understand who Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam was and how he operated and under what paradigm. This same Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam is the value and worth we see in every human being, because he was the only man that removed sand from the eyes of every girl when that girl was being buried by her own father. This is Muhammad. Where do you find a paradigm like the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam? Where? You tell me. And today girls are being buried in different ways. Right? Under the very guise of their own parents and their own community. And no one speaks out. Right? No one speaks out. That's what makes Muhammad Muhammad. Sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. That's what makes Muhammad the human. Muhammad the pure, the soul. Remember my word in the beginning? You are a soul with a personality. Don't make yourself a personality with a soul. Very important. Very important. To always act upon your soul, not upon your personality. Then, this very Muhammad, he is the one who used to say, I am a mercy to my family, while fathers were ashamed of their own daughters. You know, they buried them alive. And the Prophet ﷺ would ask these people after they turned to Islam, relate to me what you used to do to your daughters. And they would come in front of Rasulullah and relate to him how they used to hail the sand over their tiny little daughters while Rasulullah is crying, salawatullah wa salamu alayhi, when Allah reveals to the Prophet's content and to the Prophet's satisfaction, وَإِذَا الْمَوْءُودَةُ سُئِلَتْ بِأَيِّ ذَنْبٍ قُتِلَتْ. When the infant girl shall be asked on the day of judgment, for what sin has she committed to be treated in that fashion? Right? Look at the profoundness of our legislation. Muhammad is the love and care for my enemies, and he is the respect and honor of my friends and family. Salawatullah wa salamu alayhi. None other than the Prophet can assume that particular status. Muhammad is the human rights that I carry. He is the equality between me and every other human being. He is the modesty and worth of my existence. Salawatullah wa salamuhu alayhi. Muhammad is the one that removed ignorance and envy from the hearts of people around him. He is the humbleness of every man's heart and the cleanser of arrogance and hatred. Muhammad is the remover of pride and arrogance and vanity in men. This is Rasulullah. And when you want to present Rasulullah, present him as such a paradigm to humanity. And communicate your message with these, you know, people that live around us. I'm not talking about us, brothers and sisters. We must go beyond the confinement of our mosque. We must reach out to our neighbors. Our neighbors, you know, sometimes, sorry to say that, we say we are being discriminated against. Whoa. Well, we are the most discriminatory race on earth. We Muslims, let's face reality. We, in fact, within us, the most discriminate race among us. Arabs don't come to Indo-Pakistan centers. Indo-Pakistan don't go to Arab centers. Afghanis don't come into Iranian centers. Iranians don't come into Afghanistan. Thank God for Masjid-e-Ali. Thank God. We have somewhere where we can breathe our Arabs, who Afghanis, who Kojas, who Indo-Pak, who everyone, that they come join hand in hand for the love of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, for the love of Imam Hussein salawatullah wa salamu alayhi, for the love of these people that incorporated the love of others within their hearts in order to tell the human race that we will never be allowed to be hijacked by one race. Huh? But we are here to be shared equally by every race. These are Ahlul Bayt Salamullah Alayhim. Ma'lish, sometimes, yani forgive me. Maybe my words are a bit harsh. I ask for your forgiveness, wallah. But you think my words are harsh because I want, God forbid, to fly 28 hours from Australia to Masjid Ali in New Jersey so that I can blurb out these words? La wallah. Wallah al-azim, Allah is my witness. The only purpose and the only cause for me to say this is out of love for one another to grow and go beyond our parameters that we live in. And beyond. Our Imam, salawatullah wa salam alayhi ruhi wa arwahul alameen, liturabi maqdamihi al-fida. May our lives and our, you know, wealth be the sacrifice of the return of al-Imam al-Hujjat ibn al-Hasan ajalallah ta'ala farajahu sharif. He's watching us. He's witnessing us. He is saying to us, I long to see you. I long to see you, not we long to see him. Right? Because what does Imam represent, brothers and sisters? And I'll move on. Imam is the epitome of knowledge. Knowledge and ignorance cannot survive by one, next to one another. The more we turn into ignorance, the more the distance between us and the Imam increases. The more we grow with knowledge of the purpose of our existence, both on the basis of any form of knowledge that performs, that reforms and promotes our humanity. Because I'm not a believer that there are two types of knowledge in this world. There is a knowledge of what we call religious knowledge and secular knowledge. What sort of a statement is this? Any beneficial knowledge is knowledge. Any beneficial knowledge is religious knowledge, right? Is religious knowledge. Why? Because it goes for the reform and the promotion of the human race. So if there is benefit in it, then there is satisfaction and rida to Allah in pursuing it. Right? So that we can be a true community that extends its goodness to others. Right? That Imam is saying, come closer to me, shed your ignorance. Shed your ignorance. Don't allow your prejudices to come into your existence. Imam Zain al-Abidin, salawatullah wa salamu alayhi, says this. He says, it is not asabiyya, it is not fanaticism to love your own countrymen. No problem. Love the Pakistanis. The Lebanese loves the Lebanese. The Iraqis love the Iraqis. The Iranians love the Iranians. The Afghanis. He said, it's not fanaticism. Then he introduces another concept. He says, but surely it is fanaticism to give preference to your countryman when he is bad over someone else's who's a mu'min. Huh? What a profound statement. Huh? Just because he's from my country, but he's evil, I'll give him my daughter in marriage. But if someone comes from a different community and he's a mu'min, nah, bana. You know, bana, I don't know. What do you say in Urdu? There's a word for it. Bana means friend, right? Or whatever. Okay, so no, that doesn't work. This is prejudice, fanaticism at its best, in the words of Imam Zain al-Abidin, salawatullah wa salamuhu alayhi. These are the people who taught us amazing, amazing selflessness when it comes to the question of giving, to the question of sacrifice, to the question of not reserving anything for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And here I'm reminded at the time when Sayyida Zainab was watching from Talla Zaynabia, Allah, and she's looking at the battle. Allah. Allah. She's looking into the battlefield, and due to the harshness of the clashes of the swords and the attack on Imam Hussein, salawatullah wa salamuhu alayh, there comes a moment where she could not see Imam Hussein anymore. She can't see him anymore due to the, you know, abruption of the sand and the wind and all these clashes that are taking place and the horses running, you know, around the Imam salawatullahi wa salam alayhi when he ended up, you know, falling down from his horse. So she runs to the tent. She goes into the tent and she says, Oh nephew. She says to Imam Zain al-Abidin, I cannot see your father. Imam Hussein salawatullah wa salam alayhi. He said, Ammati sannidini. He says, my amma, give me your hand, you know, give me some assistance to stand up. Then he takes his stick. Imam Zain al-Abidin was 23 years old. He needs a stick, salawat. You can imagine the pain and suffering he had to sustain in Karbala that he has to actually use a stick to stand up, salawatullah wa salamuhu alayhi. So he says, sannidini amma. So she gives him some support and he goes towards the door of the tent. He opens the tent. He looks, salawatullah wa salamu alayhi. He says, ammati zainab. إن أبي قد سقط عن صهوة جوادي. He says, oh, Auntie Zainab, my father Hussein had fallen down from his saddle into the ground. That's why you are unable to see him. My thoughts and your thoughts, brothers and sisters, will go now to Medina. When the caravan arrives, being headed by Imam Zainul Abidin, Bishr ibn Hazlam was a poet. He comes to Imam Zainul Abidin salawatullah wa salamu alayhi and he says, what happened? He says, go Bishr, you are someone that knows how to recite poetry. Go and give eulogies and pronounce the return of the caravan of Ahlul Bayt salamullah alayhim ajma'in. So Bishr goes to the grave of Rasulullah. He says, يا أهل يثرب لا مقام لكم قتل الحسين بكربلاء فأدمعي مدرارا. He says, oh people of Medina, how are you able to sit quietly and settle down while Hussein has been martyred in Karbala? And I spare no tears over him. What happened? Why is this happening? He says, come and witness for yourselves what happened to these people. So when the caravan of the people of Ahlul Bayt salamullah alayhim, Kalthum bi abi wa ummi, Kalthum, the daughter of Imam Ali, when she witnesses the houses of Medina as they are approaching on the back of the camels, she begins to read the following verses of poetry. Medina tu jaddina la taqbalina. O city of our grandfather, do not accept us to enter your boundaries. Fabil hasarat wal ahzan Anjina. Surely with bereavement and sorrows we have returned. Ala fa akhbir Rasulullah anna bi anna qad fujna fi abina. surely inform Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi that we have bereaved, we have been bereaved by the death and martyrdom of our father. Madinatu jaddina la taqbalina fabil hasarati wal ahzani jina kharajna minki bil ahlina jam'an raja'na la rijal wala banina. We left Medina in the company of our children and our brothers and women folk. But today we return. Today we return, and no men are amongst us, no children. Our men in Taf has been killed, and their heads have been severed from their bodies. O people, inform our grandfather Rasulullah that after we wear the honor and the pride of the women of the house of Rasulullah, we come back today as prisoners of war. Ya Rasulullah, this is the epitome, this is the apex, brothers and sisters, listen to what she says. Ya Rasulullah, they killed your Hussein, salawatullah wa salamu alayhi, without giving any due respect to the fact that he was your grandson. They killed him without any due respect that you are his grandfather, ya Rasulullah. Oh Rasulullah, if only you were to witness when we were taken prisoners of war on the back of camels, surely, ya Rasulullah, your eyes would not leave us of out of protection and your gaze. Oh Rasulullah, you always protected us with your gaze, but when we were taken prisoners of war, we looked towards Medina, but we didn't find you. Ya Rasulullah, أفاطم لو نظرت إلى السبايا بناتك في البلاد مشتتين أفاطم لو نظرت إلى الحيارة ولو أبصرت زين العابدين أفاطم لو رأيتينا سهارا ومن سهر الليالي قد عمينا أفاطم ما لقيت من عداك ولا قراط مما قد لقينا. She says, oh Fatima, if only you saw your daughters being paraded in the streets of captivity, surely you would have looked at us in perplexity, and you could not take your gaze away from Zainul Abidin. Fatima, I'm telling you, Kulthum is saying this to her mother, salawatullah. She says, by Allah, O mother, if you compare your suffering to our suffering, you would acknowledge that our suffering in comparison to you is not worth an atom weight of what we had endured. Inna lillah wa inna ilayhi raji'un. Wa sayalamu alladhina zalamu ala Muhammadin. أيام قلب ينقلبون. Brothers and sisters, before I leave my majlis, before I leave my podium, I want you to turn to Allah with your raised hand high. Remember our brothers in Iraq, Pakistan, Afghanistan, Palestine, those who are suffering, those who are being persecuted, those who are being killed for their belief system. Our brothers and sisters who have asked us to pray for them so that Allah will take away their bereavement, take away their sadness, take away their problems. Those who have been challenged, oh Allah, make their challenge a bit light on them. Those who are sick, oh Allah, cure them. Oh Allah, if we have any enmity or hatred towards any of our Muslim brothers, our mu'min brothers, oh Allah, cleanse our heart with thy love in these holy nights and answer our prayers 5 times from your time with the loudest of your salah, with the loudest of your voices. Bismillahir Rahmanir Rahim. Amman yujib
يجيب المضطر إذا دعاه ويكشف السوء أمن يجيب المضطر إذا دعاه ويكشف السوء louder أمن أمن يجيب المضطر إذا دعا ويكشف السوء The last one from the bottom of your heart أمن يجيب المضطر إذا دعا ويكشف السوء By the right of Muhammad and his family and by the sacredness of Surah Al-Mubarak Al-Fatiha proceeded with salawat ala Muhammadin wa ali Muhammad.